What's something you're working on that you're excited about?
Oh, you know, I always tend to work on bunches of things at once. We have a paper that I'm part of, although the main emphasis comes from Oliver Friedrich, who is a postdoc in Germany, on phenomenological consequences of holography. So holography, you know, I don't want to go too much into it, but the holographic principle is a big thing in physics and in quantum gravity. It says that, you know, there's a lot less going on in the world than you might think. The world is not really three-dimensional space. It can be thought of as a two-dimensional space with densely encoded quantum information, and we're just a projection of that into the world. And so Oliver and a bunch of us tried to propose a way that would actually make a difference for experimental signatures, in particular the ice cube experiment at the South Pole that is looking for high-energy cosmic rays in the Antarctic ice.
People say there are different forms of holography. So ADS-CFT is one form. What are other forms?
Well, that's a great question. You know, when I was your age, we had the holographic principle, but we didn't have ADS-CFT yet, right? The original idea came from Gerard de Tooft, Leonard Susskind, and others thinking about black hole information. You know, since Hawking's time, that the entropy of a black hole is proportional to the area of its event horizon, which on the one hand, maybe is a surprise if you think about black holes too much like a box of gas. For boxes of gas, the volume is the volume that matters when you calculate the entropy, not the area of the boundary. But for the vacuum state of a quantum field theory, it's actually very natural for areas to be proportional to entropies. So maybe from that perspective, it's not so surprising. But anyway, to try to sort of reconcile it all, Tooft and Susskind ended up proposing their version, their early version of the holographic principle, which said that the total amount of quantum information specifying the state of a black hole sort of can be thought of as living on its event horizon. There's no extra information hidden inside, deep inside the volume of the black hole. But it was very vague. Like, okay, what are you going to do with that? What do you mean lives on? You know, it wasn't quite clear what was going on. And when Juan Maldacena first came up with the ADS-CFT correspondence, he really wasn't thinking about in terms of holography. He was really thinking about supergravity and stacking brains on the throat of an extremal black hole and noticing that it looks like ADS and, you know, the very, you know, technically sophisticated, you know, typical Maldacena brilliant way of pushing things around. But the holographic idea was added on by Ed Witten. You know, Witten had known about those papers by Tooft and Susskind, and he pointed out, like, oh, you know, really, we can think of this as an equivalence between a d-dimensional space-time and a d+1-dimensional space-time, and it really implements holography in a very, very direct way. So these days, a lot of times when people talk about holography, they really mean the ADS-CFT correspondence. But there still is that earlier implication of it or version of it. You know, Raphael Busso proposed some very nice covariant versions of the original holographic idea. And so we think that even though we don't live in ADS, there still should be some version of holography in our real world. But it's not at all clear exactly how it's supposed to work.
And the one that you're working on is not ADS, not ADS-CFT.
Not ADS, supposed to be the real world, supposed to be where we live. I'm very speculative in many ways, but I still care about the world where we actually live.
Do you think that ADS-CFT gives insight into quantum gravity in universes that aren't asymptotically ADS?
Well, I don't know. You know, I think as a practical matter, probably it does, just because it's a good toy model. It's somewhere where people can ask questions and answer them. That's always good. You know, I am not a simple harmonic oscillator, but in some sense, a lot of what goes on in my body is successfully modeled by simple harmonic oscillators, right? You know, you start with things you understand and you build up complications from there. So certainly questions about, you know, holography in general, entropy, the relationship between entanglement and geometry, maybe something about black hole information and how it's preserved in evaporation. Maybe all these things can be investigated in the ADS-CFT context. But I do still think that the fact that we don't live in ADS-CFT matters in some sense. I don't think that every interesting quantum gravity question is going to be answered by looking at ADS. There's a bit of a looking under the lamppost kind of aspect where we're hoping to answer all the quantum gravity questions looking at ADS because that's what we understand. But I think that, you know, whether it's because there's a finite entropy for De Sitter space or whatever, I think this can be a fundamentally different set of things that we can and must discover outside of the ADS context.
So what is the difficulty with a duality in De Sitter space-time and CFT?
So I guess before I answer that, let me ask, who's the audience that I should be aiming at? You know, how sophisticated do we get here? I can try to be very general or very specific.
Yes. Well, the audience tends to be researchers and professors in math, physics, comp sci, philosophy. Ah. So you can speak at the graduate level if you like. In fact, this podcast, just so you know, is infamous for its technical depth.
Great.
People appreciate when we delve into the recondite inner workings and the abstruse mechanics. They appreciate and they crave the details on TOE.
Okay, cool. So in the ADS-CFT correspondence, there's two kind of amazing things that happen that are crucially important to the success of the correspondence. Probably more than just two, but let me highlight two. And of the two I'm going to highlight, one is obvious and everyone highlights it, and the other one is kind of underplayed, I think. The obvious one is that if you're since the time of Roger Penrose, who figured out how to do conformal diagrams, that is to say, to take a whole big space-time and to shrink it down to a finite piece of paper and look at and think about the infinity of that space-time in a rigorous, careful, mathematically respectable way, one of the nice things about anti-De Sitter space is that its boundary at infinity is a space-time. It has, you know, if you're in D plus one dimensional anti-De Sitter space, so you have D dimensions of space, one dimension of time, the boundary is a space-time of dimension D, so D minus one dimensions of space and one dimension of time. So it's this sort of naturally a hope that you can relate the dynamics in the bulk to the dynamics in the boundary. They're both dynamical theories. They both have space where you can define initial conditions and you have time where you can evolve it. The other thing that is not as celebrated but also crucially important in anti-De Sitter space is that anti-De Sitter space is infinitely big. Even if you think that a finite region of space only has a finite dimensional Hilbert space, which might be suggested to you by the holographic principle or by black hole entropy or whatever, in ADS, there's an infinite number of finite regions of space. So the theory as a whole naturally has an infinite dimensional Hilbert space. And therefore, the boundary theory can and turns out to be sensibly be a quantum field theory that has an infinite dimensional Hilbert space. So not only is it a theory, a dynamical theory at the boundary all by itself, but it's the kind of theory we know and love that we have really been working on for a long time. Now in De Sitter space, where you have a positive cosmological constant, and let's forget for the moment, put aside the fact that there's also a Big Bang and there's matter in the universe and whatever, let's just think very simply about De Sitter space. Both of those nice features no longer are true. Number one, the conformal boundary of De Sitter space is space-like, not time-like. It's partly a sphere in the future and partly a sphere in the past. And number two, it depends on how you slice De Sitter space, but you can slice it so that the volume at any one spatial slice is finite. And in particular, an observer inside a horizon sees a finite dimensional horizon entropy that they want to associate with that. So for the purposes of an observer in De Sitter, again, we don't know the answers for sure, but it's at least plausible that if there is a holographic description, it is in terms of a finite dimensional Hilbert space. And it might not be a field theory, right? Because field theories have infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces. And it might not be a theory with any time dependence because it's not a space-like, a time-like boundary. So I think that there's, you know, profound differences between ADS and DS, and we haven't quite wrapped our brains around them. There's very admirable attempts to think about what holography would look like in de Sitter space. Celestial holography is the most popular approach right now, but none of it is anywhere nearly as advanced and reliable as what we know in anti-de Sitter.
Is there a bound in the finite dimensional case? Like it tells you that the maximum dimensions of the Hilbert space is 25, or is it just you know that there exists some n?
No, we actually know the number. So, you know, whenever you have two things, number one, a system with a finite entropy, a finite entanglement entropy. Let's be careful that we really need to assume that we're talking here about the von Neumann entropy, the quantum mechanical entanglement entropy of one system with the rest of the world. If you know what that entropy is, and you know that it's the maximum entropy that the system can have, that there's no way to increase the entropy by changing its quantum state or its entanglement or whatever, then you have a pretty good idea the dimensionality of its Hilbert space. It's roughly E to the entropy. I say roughly because it depends on, you know, are you on in microcanonical or canonical ensemble or whatever? What are you keeping fixed, et cetera? But, you know, that's the order of magnitude. And so we think that de Sitter space is a maximum entropy configuration. I even wrote a paper, you know, putting forward a quantitative argument to that extent. But people have thought it was true for long before our paper. And the entropy of a causal patch, that is to say, the entropy of a region that an observer has access to causally, is, guess what? The area of its event horizon divided by, you know, in Planck units, divided by 4, just like the entropy of a black hole. So if you have a maximum entropy state and it has a finite entropy, that implies that you can describe that system quantum mechanically by finite dimensional Hilbert space. And the answer for our observed cosmological constant is that the entropy, that the dimensionality of Hilbert space is of order 10 to the 10 to the 122. So that's a big number, but it's still finite. There's a big difference between infinity and just a big number. And that's actually what we take advantage of in our paper.
So is that a point against DS-CFT, or is it to be taken as a clue that this holography doesn't describe our universe?
So my guess, and this is just a guess, and it could be wrong, and I'm not even the world's expert, is that there will be DS holography, but it won't be with a CFT. It will not be with a conformal field
theory.
The
standard model isn't even a CFT, by the way, for people who are listening and wondering.
That's right, but I don't even think it'll be a field theory. Because I think it'll be, you know, something more discrete, something with it, either a finite or a countable number of dimensions of Hilbert space.
Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Curt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.